Hello and welcome to another video tutorial on Chia programming. Today we're going to be looking at singletons and how you can use them to create Ethereum-like contracts in Chia. The first question you may have is, what is a singleton? Well, a singleton is an indivisible, uniquely identifiable coin. The singleton's unique identifier is called its launcher ID, which is the coin ID of the coin that created the first singleton of this singleton's history. And the reason that we want singletons is that they can be used to represent things that we need to be unique on the blockchain, such as identities or NFTs. Singletons share a lot in common with NFTs, but are more powerful broadly. A lot of the time with Chia, if you have got a complex application, the puzzle hash will be changing a lot, the coin IDs will be changing a lot, and it can be difficult to keep track of and prevent frauds and fakes. In Chia, anybody can copy a puzzle hash or a puzzle reveal. So if you want something to be provably unique, it needs to have some extra rules to prevent this from happening. These extra rules can give us confidence when we communicate with a coin on-chain that it is the authentic coin that we care about. The other great advantage to singletons is if you look up the launcher ID, you can follow it and find the current state of the singleton. This effectively allows it to be comparable to an address in Ethereum. However, there are some subtle nuances that I need to get into on why it's not exactly the same. Firstly, let's look at how singletons work. If any of you have looked at the colored coin videos I did a while back, this should seem kind of familiar. As always with Chia, we should start by thinking what rules we want a coin to have to enforce our desired goal. For us, we want it to be provably unique. We can do this by making the coin have the following rules. The coin must only create one coin, which is the singleton successor. The coin must be following legitimate singleton rules. The coin's parent must also be following the same rules that the coin is. By making sure that our parent is following the same rules as us, we get a nice little bit of recursive history where we know that our complete lineage is legitimate. As you can see in this diagram, the most recent coin is at the bottom and it knows that it's valid. It also knows that its parent is valid, who in turn knew that its parent was valid, and so on. You get the picture. It's easy enough to assert that you are a singleton and your parent is a singleton, but making only one singleton poses an interesting problem. How do you stop people sneaking extra singletons out? We want people to be free to create as many new coins as they want, but if they made two singletons, then they'd both have the same history and we'd have a duplicate. It wouldn't be provably unique. How do we stop someone sneaking out a second singleton? What we can do is add a rule that all singletons must be odd in order to be valid, and then we can check the outputs and see that only one of our outputs has odd value. This way, if they try and sneak out two odd singletons, we catch them and they fail. And if they put an extra singleton in the even outputs, it won't be valid. This effectively guarantees that we only ever have one legitimate, spendable singleton output. So that covers our three rules, but you might be wondering how all of this starts, how the launcher ID comes into this. Let's take a look. What we can do is make a very small tweak to the my parent rule and change it to my parent must have the same rules as me or be the origin coin. This works really nicely, but if we're being thorough, we must make sure that the origin coin is not creating more than one of these singletons. Otherwise, again, we might have a duplicate on the network. This means that we need to make the origin coin have a custom puzzle that only creates one output, but we need to make this puzzle universal so that all singletons have the same format. This means that we cannot embed our specific singleton puzzle inside the launcher puzzle. It must be passed through the solution. But if we have a universal puzzle, how do we secure that parameter? Because we can't sign it with a public key, we need to come up with something else that will help us secure it. To do this, we can use announcements. You should already be familiar with announcements by now. They're used to create messages between coins during spends. If we set our launcher puzzle to announce the puzzle that's being passed in, when we create our launcher coin, we can assert that that announcement exists. And because all conditions are evaluated at the same time, this is valid. This is what the spend bundle looks like. You can see that it's spending two coins. The parent coin is the standard coin, and the parent coin is asserting an announcement from the launcher coin. You see that the launcher coin is being spent to create our singleton, but it also creates the announcement. So they both have to be there. And if the announced puzzle is wrong, then the launcher coin is never even created. It's like the movie Back to the Future, where you can interrupt your parent from ever creating you, except it all happens at the same time. Okay, so we've created a singleton, and we know what the singleton layer is doing, what rules it's enforcing. But what does it actually look like? How do you use it? Well, the singleton supports an inner puzzle. The singleton doesn't care about what the inner puzzle is. The inner puzzle will be up to the owner of the singleton. This will be stuff like, I control this coin, and the rules related to ownership. However, the singleton layer needs to make sure that the inner puzzle is kept in check. So it filters in some information from the solution. And once the inner puzzle returns its list of conditions, the outer puzzle will do the check related to odd values and otherwise permit everything to go through. One thing to be aware of when writing programs for inner puzzles is that the outer layer will automatically wrap the odd create coin condition in a singleton layer. It will take the puzzle hash and use that to calculate a wrapped puzzle hash with the singleton layer as a part of it. There's one last piece of program modification trickery that we do. One thing we discovered when using singletons is that if you have a smart inner puzzle, a lot of the time you would end up recalculating or re-verifying information that you'd already calculated and verified in the singleton layer. We found that we could mitigate this by just passing this information through so the inner puzzle can access it knowing that it's already been verified to be true. We call these truths. This ends up saving a considerable amount of time because the singleton layer actually calculates quite a lot. The full list of truths that we pass through to the inner puzzle are the coin ID, the coin puzzle hash, the inner puzzle hash, the amount, the lineage proof, and the singleton's information. That is the launcher ID, the launcher puzzle hash, and the singleton mod code. The singleton information consists of the singleton code, the launcher code, and the launcher ID. We can now create a uniquely addressable stateful singleton. To store the state, we just put it inside of the inner puzzle, and we can track the coin through the launcher ID and trace the odd output every time. However, the state inside the coin is not necessarily transparent. Given that you lock a coin up with a puzzle hash, if you don't know what the pre-image to that hash is, you don't know what the state is, but we can design around this. Imagine you're playing a game of chess. If the board starts at the default, you already know what the inner puzzle will look like, and you don't need any extra information. But let's say we're playing a game of chess where the board can be any size and any starting position. In that situation, any onlooker is going to need some clues so that they can recreate the puzzle slash puzzle hash. This is quite important, so I'm going to go through another example with pictures. Here, we know what the standard chessboard looks like, and the puzzle hash for that here is 0xAC648. We know if we see a coin created with AC648 that puzzle hash is chess, and we know what to do with it and we can play. But if someone creates double chess, that's going to have a different puzzle hash here of B1BA. So if someone creates a coin with B1BA, we're not going to recognize it, and we're not going to be able to recreate that puzzle to spend the coin to make our move. But if someone also spends it and on the blockchain includes in the extra data some chess setup info, we can recognize chess setup info and use that to build locally an idea of what the chessboard looks like. And then we can recreate the puzzle, and then we can spend the coin and play the game. For the sake of extensibility and future compatibility, we format extra data as key value pairs. And we can put any information in a key value pair, but it helps for when scanning the blockchain to have this data annotated in a human readable format. Finally, I want to conclude with two short tips that you can use and think about when writing singletons. The first tip is that you can have nested inner puzzles. It doesn't just have to be an outer layer and an inner layer. You can have as many layers and inner layers as you want. So you could have an inner layer that has standardized code. In this PowerPoint slide, I've suggested that maybe Chia buddies, you could have a standardized Chia buddy layer that handles things like breeding and trading and getting stats. But then there's an inner layer for the owner of that Chia buddy to control the ownership. And the second tip is that you can make payments to singletons. You just have to send the coin to a puzzle that can only be spent if it receives an announcement from the singleton that is currently owned by that launcher ID. In fact, we do this on the network at the moment. payments to singletons allow you to do things like only create a payment to the owner of a specific Chia buddy, maybe as an offer that you want to buy that Chia buddy. There's been a lot of information in this video, but hopefully it's got you thinking about some cool things that you can do with our provably unique addressable singletons. If you have any questions, feel free to ask us at the Q&A, and if you've missed the Q&A, feel free to ask us on Keybase. Thank you.